Someone's connecting audio. We'll give her a second to get connected if that happens. Oh, she's still waiting. All right, we'll get started. Okay, so this session is COVID-19 compliance and IT issues, facilitated by Brian Keyes, Senior VP of Operations for Connor Concepts. The pandemic has been challenging, if not devastating, for many of us. Crisis management was certainly in play, and we were all immersed in a fluid scenario as the world seemed to change dramatically daily. Restaurateurs found themselves throwing stuff at the wall to see what they could, what could gather revenue. Furloughing employees and dealing with technicalities and paperwork, meaning federal funding, return to work, was burdensome and emotionally troubling. This discussion and the discussion in this session will focus on what have we learned and where were the silver linings? How did IT play a role in our success? And what new initiatives were operators forced to implement? With that, I pass it on to Brian and take it away.
Okay, thank you very much, Kevin. Again, when you talk about COVID compliance, you're mainly looking at, I think, restrictions and all the things that are got in our way, roadblocks, challenges, et cetera. How do we be compliant with the things that we have to do and still survive as a business and be effective? And, you know, certainly IT played a major, major role in this in 2020. A little bit about us real quickly. We have two main concepts, the Chop House and Connor Steak and Seafood. And we have 14 locations, mainly in the southeastern part of the U.S. You see the states there. We're polished casual dining. I'm in charge of IT for the company, VP of operations, and I teach food safety, which sort of led me to be also in charge of COVID. So I played a major role and chaired a committee that tackled and battled things during the pandemic. 2020, not a year to remember, certainly for any of us. My heart goes out to many of you that are in this conference. I realize that we may have had it more favorable in our geographic locations. You know, I want to focus on the positives in this presentation and the silver linings and talk about how IT was useful. I do want to have a sense of humor because I think that's important always, especially in trying times. But I don't think this is anything to joke about. The following slides are meant to just generate your thoughts and to help for the discussion at the end. So if you would, please jot down your questions and save them for the end. That's how I'd like to do it so I can get through these slides. You can also put questions in the chat. March 2020, we've already talked about this today, COVID landed in the US. And here's a illustration of a guy stranded on a remote tropical island that's trying to avoid being rescued by the cruise ship. Crisis management kicked in. If you didn't have a crisis management plan, boy, you quickly developed one. Toilet paper became quite limited and valuable. And hand sanitizer too. Everyone was told put hand sanitizer all throughout your restaurants, but you had a real hard time getting it. We adopted a motto of be safe and see safe. And everything we did, we wanted our guests to be able to see what we were doing to keep them safe, whether it's sanitizing items, whether it is signage, whether it is social distancing. And we wanted to make sure that they saw it in action, not just words, but action. As we've talked many times today, a Zoom or Microsoft Net meetings became the way to do business. Obviously, people got to share their pets. Some people never figured out the lighting thing. Some people played around with their backgrounds constantly. And I love the guy in the lower left corner. That was, I know a guy just like that. Anyway. You know, it was almost like Pac-Man. Which way do we go? Constant daily innovation and change. We had to do that. We had to change on the fly and make decisions. And we as IT execs were tremendously challenged. We were throwing stuff at the wall just to see what would stick. We try anything. We basically became ghost kitchens. When everybody closed and all they could do was to go, we became ghost kitchens and learned what that was like. Many jumped into third party or home delivery if they hadn't already been doing that. We were one of those. Everybody had to have very efficient, very fast. I love that term that Red Lobster used, rapid curbside, or whatever they called it. But I think the speed of that was really important. It had to be efficient. You had to be able to deliver it when you were promising. You had to keep the line moving. You had to have a tent and signage just to let the public know that you were open. I mean, if you didn't have a tent, I don't think you did a whole lot of business on curbside. Contactless payments became popular, even for guys that were trying to rob people. When we reopened at sometime May, June-ish for some, it was different. Might've been 25%, might've been 50%. It was very, very awkward to wear masks and have people come in your restaurants. We actually had a server that would go up to tables and say, you can't tell right now, but I'm smiling. Other people decided to just put their smile on the front of the mask. It became crazy inside the restaurants with the environment, signage all over the place, masks, restrictions, all these rules, not a very welcoming environment. Again, be safe and see safe became really important. Social distancing was really strange and awkward, but it was easier to find Waldo. I call this ultimate plastic barrierization. We had to do what we could do to get people in the restaurants and make sure that there were barriers and we were following the law. Some people would use stuffed animals and try to create the right distance between the tables so that diners could sit at those tables. Outdoor domed seating, even if it's outside, it still had to be covered and separated. Not bumper cars, but bumper bars, inner tubes to create social distancing, even outside. And pool noodle hats. I love this. This is in Germany, I think, and real attention getting, not let alone social distancing. Indoor dating pods. What's the world coming to, right? In the fourth quarter, many people became non-caring and bar areas became difficult to manage. It turned out that the new thing might be COVID-safe seating areas and non-COVID-safe seating areas. Bars and restaurant might be more of the non-safe areas, but as restaurateurs, we need to provide safe seating areas with social distancing for other people. Many don't care, many still do care. Holiday season was, our sales were way, way down. We do a tremendous amount of large party business, as I'm sure many of you guys do. Losing that business was huge. The virus tended to peak in our locations at that time, and staffing became more challenging than ever with people that couldn't work because they had to be exposed or they knew somebody that was exposed, et cetera. For the first time ever, I was gifted hand sanitizer in my stocking. So how did Chop House and Connor Steak and Seafood battle this pandemic? Number one, we enacted a crisis management plan, which I will say thank you to this group because this was something that I learned at an IT meeting, executive study group meeting, and we actually had this in place, not necessarily for Corona, but for anything that would happen with us. So we had a plan, we enacted it. We had daily executive Zoom meetings. They became daily at first. Everything changed on a daily basis, and then we eventually would go to every other day, and we became less frequent ongoing. Paused all capital expenditures. We were gonna roll out Restaurant 365 right in the beginning of 2020, but that's been delayed to midway through this year. Extremely profit focused, analyzing and reviewing every single penny spent. We temperature screened all of the guests and employees who came in our restaurant with a non-contactless thermometer on the forehead. No one ever temped over 100.4. And that was interesting because, and that was a lot of people, that was employees and guests. So we discontinued that at some point. Again, I shared that motto with you that we had, contact tracing and the CDC guideline chart. That was one of the things that I was in charge of. And, it's very, very difficult to try to draw the lines between who contacted who, and then who did their friends contact, and all that. It's a nightmare. And so I think that what we learned is those contact tracing lines are quite blurry. How do you define, okay, did I walk by that person? Does that mean they're in this level of restriction or whatever? And it's also based on trust. Are the people that you're asking the questions about researching contact tracing telling you the truth, so they're not told they can't work for 10 days. So, you know, it's a very, you know, it's a very high integrity situation to know the truth of what goes on there. We had two options, either 20% off all, that was liquor, beer and wine and food, or we gave them, in some restaurants, we did free home delivery. And that was, they were both successful. Both, one was not necessarily more successful, but they both seemed to work well. We felt with 20% off that, you know, gosh, it's hard for everybody and many people are off work. So we wanted to do what we could to drive business and to get our curbside going. Our curbside volume was very strong. We had to learn to get very, very efficient on the fly. As I mentioned, we had tents and all that to make sure people knew. We also did some, we talked about this earlier with groceries. We offered groceries to people at just a few dollars above cost. We did family value meals. They were limited in their success. We implemented third-party delivery. We had not been doing that beforehand. I'll get more to that in a minute. We dummied down all our menus for curbside and third-party delivery because we wanted to be able to execute to go well, and we were limited in the amount of chefs that we were able to get back to work. So we had to make it easy to do. We implemented online ordering with the NCR Aloha Takeout software. Here are some slides to show that. Here's the landing page for Chop House, that one concept we have. And here's your menu navigation page for that. Had really professional pictures taken for that. And we also, if you want to get a steak, you might see these four options on the steak page. And you would scroll down to see more options. With our other concept, Connors, here's that menu navigation page, followed by some examples of signature cuts, followed by some examples of seafood specialties. Okay, so I said I get back to the third-party delivery. We first jumped in and did Uber Eats, Grubhub, and DoorDash. And we had some success with all three, but then we made a decision to negotiate to make DoorDash our sole third-party delivery provider. We were able to get a very attractive percentage rate with them. We did charge what I would call premium pricing on the third-party delivery platform. So they were all about 15% higher than our normal pricing. But when we negotiate with DoorDash, we actually can make money if people do third-party delivery now. But we are just like Red Lobster. We do everything we can within our marketing to get people to go to our online ordering because it's a better price for them. And we would much rather do curbside pickup than have DoorDash deliver it. We're happy to do it. It's the option. If you want home delivery, it's going to be DoorDash. But you know, the food's hotter, it's fresher. We can control what we're doing a lot better if we're able to get people to come pick up the food. So our marketing is directed. We advertise DoorDash as our home deliverer. It's on our website. It's on everything we do, but we're really going after the order online and curbside service. All right, we increased our web traffic substantially during the pandemic. We increased our social media marketing. We tried to market for gift cards. We certainly didn't sell more gift cards than the previous year, but we were up in gift card sales as a percentage of sales, net sales for the restaurant. Curbside dollars during the pandemic were averaging about 30% of normal revenue. So that was just a lot going out the door, and it continues to be around those levels. Once we were allowed to do dine-in, we basically doubled our sales, and then it just grew from there. The biggest challenges that we saw this year, number one, obviously, is just keep the restaurant company open, keep it viable. Our thing that we wanted to do was we wanted to keep all of our salaried managers and corporate people fully on payroll. Some corporate people took pay cuts. We had to furlough our staff. We tried to feed them. We tried to keep in touch with them. We tried to have empathy. The paperwork we dealt with was obviously very challenging for furloughing and getting people to come back to work and unemployment. That was a nightmare. Rehiring, recruiting, retraining our staff probably was our biggest challenge, getting people to come back to work that were happy with the unemployment deal. And it still is a challenge. And, you know, it's difficult in an environment where you're wearing masks and you're not doing normal stuff to train people and get them to understand the way you do things. You know, staffing, as I mentioned during the holidays, became very, very challenging because of the virus peaking and the sales we're trying to increase. Lunch sales, we noticed major drops in lunch sales due to so many people working from home. And we also noticed our PPA dollar amounts per guest were down at dinner because of so much curbside and lacking the opportunity to do suggestive sales. So looking ahead, we would like to go into contactless payments, which happens to be a session that Kathy is running right now on one of these other choices. We want to enable QR codes on a lot of things we do to make people go to our website so we can focus on promoting online ordering. We have not really gone after marketing of online order heavily. We rolled it out in November, so we didn't want the holidays to be crazy. So we are now in the process of really going after that. We're going to consider loyalty and email marketing. That's a maybe. We requiring the staff to get vaccine. I highly doubt that will be legal, but it is interesting to think about that being a quality statement. You know, all of our staff is vaccinated. That I wonder if any restaurants will try to do that. Expansion in 2022. We're trying to get some construction projects started. We definitely want to start growing our company again and obviously get back to normalcy. So that's the end of my talk. I would love to know any questions that anybody has for me. I hope I didn't rush through that too quickly. I wanted to allow room for questions. And, you know, please share what have been the silver linings for you guys during the pandemic and what new IT initiatives did you enact? This is, you know, at the end of the day, talking with this group, it's kind of a summary. A lot of these things have already been talked about. So I'll just open it up and ask for questions.
One of the things I'll offer relative to what I'll call new initiatives, it was for us, it was less about new initiatives. There were certainly some things that we were doing that were a little bit different. We had the restaurant employment, the restaurant employee rescue fund that we ran. But for technology, it was a lot of rapid response that we ended up engaging in and pivoting with the business. So doing some things that we, you know, normally would do, or maybe a little twist on something like building some websites, you know, overnight that we didn't have. But it was a lot about rapid response. And that's where I feel was also a silver lining that, you know, technology was able to demonstrate our ability to solve problems quickly and come up with ways to be innovative on behalf of the business. So, you know, both of those things worked really well for us.
Thank you. Anybody else have any questions?
You know, I don't really have a question, but, you know, it's interesting, your presentation and then thinking back to Corey's presentation. When you think back to the timeline of just the last 11, even 10 months, it is pretty amazing, you know, how quickly everyone has reacted and responded to, you know, to the situation. You know, for some of us like Red Lobster, who, I mean, we were fortunate in that just by mid-February, we had finished almost a 2.5 to 3 year program of standing up a whole e-commerce platform. And we were actually just rolling out version 2 of our e-commerce platform at that point in mid-January, and to think that 8 weeks later, we were going to turn into basically a to-go business. It's very challenging to think of, I mean, I'm sure my team and the rest of the Red Lobster team would have been able to react, but we were fortunately in a position to where our focus over the last 10 months has really been kind of tweaking workflows, filling in gaps. I mean, it wasn't anything major. Like, I mean, to your point, Kathy, when you talk to her about her story of having to stand up, digital ordering and all of the process change that they had to put in place, and they did it all in 2 weeks is pretty amazing.
Well, we jumped into these things fairly quickly, but we had to enhance them over time. You start out and you just, you know, like we didn't offer everything to go. We only offered some, and then we added things. Our guest told us that, you know, hey, I appreciate that you're doing market fresh groceries, and I appreciate you're doing family value meals, but we just want your normal food, and everybody wants to order what they want. Yeah. So we learned very quickly that those things had limited success, and we needed to get our full menu on board, and that's just what people wanted. And we still obviously don't do some things to go, because you just can't do it. It's just not good quality. But, I think through it, Lou, and, you know, as we did things, it was so challenging. One of the biggest fears we have, we didn't do third party delivery, and we didn't have online ordering. Now we feel we have a really nice deal, but we're fearful about getting too many orders at once. I know that you guys shared that's one of our biggest fears. And so we want the business. We needed the business during the pandemic, but we also were very concerned. Like, we got Valentine's Day coming up, right? So, you know, we're very, very focused on, hey, be careful, you know, take what you can. We're all about, let's make the quote time longer, but let's take the order. And if they don't want to do it based on the quote time, that's their call, but we don't want to say no, you know, but we can't let but so many orders come in at once, you know, it's just impossible.
Yeah, that is a big challenge. And, you know, because in the old days, you could see the cars driving into the parking lot. You could see the people standing in the lobby. You could watch the seater, you know, fill up the tables, and you'd have somebody running back there going, you know, we got a bus in the parking lot. But, you know, all of these virtual orders and all of those channels, they all get busy at the same time, right? Because everybody's eating at the same time. I mean, quite honestly, we had a challenge with demand over the holidays on New Year's Eve. We just weren't ready for it. But the other issue is not so much that we weren't ready for it. It's just that you don't have the staff to handle just a spike.
Yeah.
You know, even for a 1 or 2 day event. Now we're very focused on we're calling it the build up to Mother's Day. And it starts with Valentine's weekend. You know, and then for us with seafood, we go right into Lent and then Good Friday. And that whole period of time for us, typically from the 1st of February all the way through Easter, is just, you know, a lot of people are eating seafood for various reasons. But particularly for that religious calendar of Lent, it's just a huge period of time for us. And, you know, staffing is going to be an issue.
Yeah. You know, one thing I didn't say was in this arena, lots of fine dining restaurants jumped in the to-go deal, which they never had done that before. People like Ruth Chris jumped on to Olo, and they just took the template they had and just tried to do it as fast as they could and had some success with it. But in the past, you just wouldn't think of getting, you know, necessarily going to to-go order. And places like Ruth Chris and even our Connor Steak and Seafood is a little bit upscale. We never focused on to go.
I mean, you really didn't need the demand.
You know, we have all that we can handle sometimes in the restaurant.
Exactly.
With COVID, it's here to stay now. It's a deal, and there's lots of people that want it, and I don't know how it's going to settle out, but it's going to be a factor that's something we need to be thriving in that space with.
Agreed.
All right, folks. We've got a short turnaround for this next one. Thank you, Brian. Appreciate it. And I like the aspect of looking at the silver linings. We spent a lot of time, you know, in the middle of last year feeling sorry for ourselves and, you know, suffering through being cooped up where you didn't want to be cooped up. And so, you know, thank you for looking at the positive side of things.
You're welcome.
So we're going to move on to the happy hour segment and the closing that starts in 5 minutes. So we'll see you all there. Thanks again.